Okay, so my talk will be about building real-time apps with Symfony 2. I will try to show you how to do that, and I will talk a little bit about application that we're building on Locastic based on these things. Okay. First, a little bit about me. My name is Antonio. I'm CEO in Locastic, doing development with Symfony 2 for last like 5-6 years. Also doing contribution to Sibius when I have time. Latest thing that we did, we integrate the Easy Publish file with Sibius, so maybe you read about that on Symfony blog. We also presented that on Symfony Live in Monday. About Locastic, we are web and mobile development. This is the split, our home ground where we located. Also, we are doing design things. This is our new offices. So this is this is my latest project that I'm working on last 2 weeks, I think. Okay, let's move to real-time application. So this is like really long definition about real-time application. In short words, it's application which needs to do something in frame that user sends as a mediator appearing. We need to take in mind the worst case execution time, and we call this type of application real-time computing, RTC of course. I don't want to read entire definition, because the most important thing inside this definition is a context. So when we are talking about real-time application, we need to talk about the context. If we have some response inside our required time, and if it's staying in context, we can talk about real-time applications. Everything out of the context, we cannot talk anymore about real-time application. But we need to put that context in right place. For example, if we are talking about context in power plant, and if there is some security breakdown or something like that, we need to get a response immediately, as much as possible close to the 0 milliseconds. In real-time application, that can be 1 minute, 5 seconds, 3 seconds. Of course, we want to get the data as soon as is possible because we are getting some advantages, especially if we are talking about trading or financial apps. Before I start to talk about technology, we need to understand what is real-time application. I gave you the definition, but a little bit about the history. So the real-time applications, first time I think they are not a new thing. They are started to using 10 years ago probably, and mostly in financial marketing, trades, and everything else related to financing. The first technology that supported the real-time application was Live Connect. It's actually Java applet which we put in our browsers. It could communicate with JavaScript, it could have persistent connection, and it worked. But it was third-party library, it was based as a plugin, it was a legal conflict between Microsoft and the Sun, you know how Microsoft works, and that wasn't a good solution. So it developers dropped it down. Then the HTTP-based solutions came on scene, and we got the polling, it's actually AJAX calls, long polling HTTP streaming methods. This isn't a good technology for real time, but it worked. But we consider this as a hack, because if we are polling every time sending HTTP request, is the same as a static application. So we have, I suppose that you heard about Comet. It's like umbrella term for all the hacks that we use to provide users with real time applications. Regarding the use cases, actually where we need, if we are talking about any mobile or web application, we can talk about two types of application. One is static, the regular web application, that's I think maybe 80-90% of the internet is static application, and other type of applications are real-time applications like Facebook, Twitter, Foursquare, Uber, and everything else. Real-time applications give us opportunity to focus on user experience, to provide more richer experience to end users, and we don't need to click and every time reload the page to get the new data. We are getting that in real time. It's not really real time, but in 1 second or 500 milliseconds, 300 milliseconds. These are typical use cases that are used for real-time applications. So any video conference applications, VoIP, data visualization, location tracking, online gaming, all Facebook games that you are playing, like Farmville or something else, are actually real-time applications. Chatting, every chat is a real-time application. Of course, notification, signaling, activity streams, and everything else. So basically, Facebook, Twitter are real-time application. These are some of applications that or providing real-time APIs or are real-time applications. And you can see here that practically they, their user experience is based on their real-time. Before we start with, let's call it protocols for real-time application, just quick remember about HTTP protocol. So we send requests to our server, server do something with our request and give us response. Basically as principle of Symfony 2 framework. So you got request, you serve the response to the client. The simplest, I'll say, real-time protocol is webhooks. Probably you all heard about that. It's server only, it's low update rates, it's unidirectional, so it can only go from publisher to consumer. It's server to server, you cannot use webhooks to server to client. It's average latency and high efficiency if you are talking about server machines. Pooling, actually. It's Ajax call. This is not real time application protocol or anything like this, because every time we send request, we get response. Request, response, request, response. It's quite server consuming. It's so this is basically what I told you. It's server client is as important, but low update rates. It's batched bidirectional because we are forcing that bidirectional connection. It's high latency and low efficiency. So if you have, I will show you an R example at the end of this presentation. We started our application as polling application, and it's quite consuming for server, especially if your number of users start growing. Some better method than polling is long polling, but it's still not so efficient. The difference is that you send a request to the server, and you keep that connection alive until you get some response from the server. Once you get response from the server, the connection is closed, and you are doing something with the data, and then send again new request, which starts a new connection. Again, it's server or client, it's average upgrade rate, it's batched bidirectional communication, it's average latency, average efficiency. As I said, it's still polling, it's not real-time communication. One of the most famous and maybe the best solution at the moment is WebSockets. So basically, it's persistent duplex connection between server and the client. At any moment, server or client can send something to client to server and vice versa. So basically, we have whole time, entire time we have established connection. It's not based on the HTTP protocol, it's based on the TCP protocol, and we have some events, for example, on message, which can send something to client or something to server. I will show you later, if I have time, on a demo, how it works with the PHP and Pusher. Okay, so basically, that's what I told you. The client requests a web page from a server using regular HTTP. The request executes JavaScript, which opens a connection with the server. Server and the client now can send other messages when new data on either side is available. So real-time traffic from server to client and from client to server. Fully bidirectional connection. With webhooks, it's possible to connect with another domains. It's not possible with WebSockets. It's not possible with webhooks. And basically, it supports SSL, so you can use it whenever you want. I think there is no, at the moment, there is no problems with proxy servers if you are using SSL. Okay, so TCP fully duplex single connection, server and client. Mostly, it's written for a client, but there is no any restriction that you cannot use this as a protocol on a server. Okay. This is real bidirectional, it's not forced. High update rates, low latency, and really, really high efficiency. Streaming, Streaming has like lowest latency, and it's used especially for trading applications, business decision. It's unidirectional, so you can only push it to the client. You cannot do the bidirectional communication. So it's really good for, I don't know, push messages, or in this case, for any application that needs to have in the shortest possible time the right data served to the clients. It's based on the server events, so if you want to know more, you should read the specification on server events. But basically, when something happens on a server, server push that to the client. It's low latency, high efficiency, and really, really high updated rates. Also, WebRTC, it's mostly used for client-to-client communication. So, for example, video chat or audio chat. It's bidirectional, high update rates, low latency, high efficiency. As I say, audio or video, generally peer-to-peer connection. This is how we can establish connection, how this connection works. Now I will talk something about communication patterns. We can call that in that way. So the simplest one is the simple messaging. Then a little more complicated is publish subscriber, RPC, AMI, and data synchronization. About simple messaging. So there is no any protocol, there is no any abstraction of your messages. It's just messages. It's not important how complicated is your message. It's all about delivering the message. So this fits perfectly with HTTP and the REST protocols. The problem is that it's okay if you need only one source of the data, but if you need like dozens of sources, then you need to have many persistent connections. That can be overkill for huge application. For example, if you have 100 data sources, you need to have 100 persistent connection, and that can be overkill for your server. Better way for doing that is PubSub. So basically, it's subscribing and publishing on a channel. You are defining the channels, then you publish something on that channel, and if your client is subscribed on that channel, he will get that data, and you can do whatever you want with that. It's single connection, so you can have only one connection, but you can have as much as you want, as many as you want channels. Clarity partitions complex data. It has dedicated endpoint, but this is all this is protocol, so you need to have it requires to have SDK, and that's basically it. I will show the example later. As I say, if I have time for the demo, it's quite easy, and most of hosted solution are working on this type of communication pattern. RPC and RMI, so remote procedure call and remote method. Invocation, it's basically the same thing. The difference is how they interact with your data. RMI interacts with the objects, and RPC interacts with the routines. You have API methods that you can call. This is also protocol based, so you need to have SDK. And because we are working especially in RMI with the objects, the network activity is a little bit hidden from developer. It's not so transparent as a PubSub or simple messaging. Similar thing is with the data synchronization. It's focused on the data. So if you have, for example, iPhone, Android, and web application, any changes on your data should synchronize on all devices. You also have dedicated endpoint plus protocol. It's a new thing, but it's quite powerful. Also needs SDK to work, and also hides some network activity from developer. Okay, how to pick technology? So basically, you want to start with real-time application. I think 99% of developers are asking, is the Node.js the only possible solution that you could work with? The answer is no. There is a lot of technologies that that can work with real-time applications. So even for PHP, we have React PHP, Redshift, Dnode PHP, PHP Daemon. We have some Java technology, JavaScript, of course, Node.js, but Faye, Socket.io, etc. .NET technology, Python, Ruby, and of course, language agnostic, that has most hosted services, where you don't need to care about which technology are you using. But people are connecting the Node.js with real-time application, because WebSockets are written for JavaScript API, so Node.js is like natural to use with it, because the Node.js is also built as an asynchron backend language, so it's like perfect fit for that, but it's not only solution. If you want to know more about solution by language, you can go to this link. There is like, I can show it if I have internet connection. Okay, so you have this guy is actually like evangelist of real-time applications, and a lot of stuff in my slides are from his presentation, but he did like dozens of presentations on every single theme separately. So if you want to know more, just Google it, Phil Legator, or on YouTube there is dozens of videos where he's talking about real-time application. So we have hosted real-time services, general messaging and PubSub data center. They are like separated to with communication patterns. So you have data synchronization, persistent full stack, Firebase, Google Drive, Meteor, etc. Then we have self-hosted real-time solutions. There is a lot of them. WebSocket and client libraries. And you can see there is like really a lot of things here. Okay, let's move forward. So what's about PHP? We all know that Apache is not built for real-time applications. He's built in the mind of request response. That's like idea behind PHP. And by some research, almost half internet is built on Apache server. And also the PHP is not built for real-time applications. So we don't have asynchronous calls at the moment in PHP. But real-time is not impossible with PHP. Also, someone will ask, what is with Nginx? Nginx does not offer the application platform for WebSocket support, but offers proxy support for WebSocket connection. So basically, that's like standing point of the PHP. But there is some solution how we can build this. First one is to have self-hosted. Basically, these two first are self-hosted solution, and there is hosted like third party, some cloud hosting solutions. We can divide the first two in self-hosted strictly PHP solution and self-hosted side-by-side solution. If we are talking about self-hosted PHP, we can talk about tightly coupled solution, and here's missing my slides, loosely coupled solution. It's always better to go to loosely coupled solution because we can change, for example, asynchronous stack. If we started using PHP, we can change it with Node.js with no problem. We will always have these two things. So basically, we have sync stack, that's regular PHP stack, and async stack, which provides us with the functionality for web service, for example. Okay. If we are talking about self-hosted tightly coupled, we see that we have, as I said, real-time asynchronous stack, and we have, again, here web app and real-time. This is actually when the web app and real-time stack is on the same server, but you can see that we have two stacks here. Also, we have some database, and we have some HTTP and WebSocket streaming up and down. This is PHP self-hosted solution. So we have real PHP. It's event-driven, non-blocking input-output with PHP. Also, we have Ratchet built on React PHP, which supports WebSocket, WAMP, PubSub samples, but doesn't have no HTTP fallback. The fallback is important for us because some old browsers, still don't support the WebSockets, for example. Then we need to fall back to pooling, some way, long pooling or AJAX calls. Also, we have Dnode PHP, that's RPC RMI, and PHP Daemon, which most documentation is in Russian, but maybe some of you understand that. So that's good for you.
Okay. How we can set up, for example, this self-hosted demo one, Symfony Fruit plus Ratchet? We need to have some message queue here. Redis is like perfect for that. Then we have our web app stack, message queue, real-time web stack, and they are communicating in some way. Actually, they are communicating to the Redis. So when you do something, for example, create some object in the database, you are notifying the message queue, Redis. Then message queue sends that this real-time application is subscribed on the Redis. It took that event, do what needs to be done, and then send notification to your web stack. I can show the demo from this. I hope it will work. It worked 1 hour before, but live demo is always a problem. So basically, I have a Symfony application here, and I have Ratchet here. In Ratchet, we need to have chat server. So basically, it's new chat dial server. We are set up him on this TCP IP with port, and we are initializing the Redis. And we have chat app, which do some things. For example, on init, if she receives some message, she will output that to the console. On open, she says that new connection with Redis is established. On on message, we don't do nothing. On close, we are closing the connection. On error, we are dumping the error to console. Our Symfony application is quite simple. So we basically don't have anything. We have a few actions for rendering the templates. So index action is just basic checklist, which don't work anything, it just store something to our database, to the stream. Chat slash framework, so we have Ratchet, we have Pusher, and we have Fire, but Fire, I have some problems with Node.js on my virtual machine, so I skip that demo. And we have get message, post message actions. Get message, receive the message from the JavaScript part, store that to, no, sorry, it get all the messages from our database and send it as a JSON, and post message, store that to our database, and if you are using Pusher, we will use this. If you are using Ratchet, we will use Redis. So we just say, okay, we have new event, it's new message, this is data of the message, encode it to the JSON, establishing the new connection with the Redis, publishing that to Redis, and we will need, and we should have chat working. So basically this is okay. Okay, I'm logged in. Okay. So basically, I send message from here. It appears there. I can do vice versa, of course. Okay. This is my tool. It has some problem with the calendar. I don't know why. So this is like, if you started to messing up with real-time application, probably the chat will be the first thing that you will do. It's like easiest thing, and you'll see the principle how it works. The key actually I didn't show yet is in this core chat. Okay, we have all this post message and everything else, but for this Ratchet.js, this is the entire JS code that you need to have, like connection to WebSocket on the port where your WebSocket on IP and the port where WebSocket are working. You will on open event you will get connection established on message. That's like when we send a new message to the Redis, then this event on message is hitted.
and we just checking if that is a new message, then add message to our chat.
Okay, that's the first stack that you can use, but it's not recommended yet to. You can use this in production, but the one of the lead developers on this project say it's not yet recommended. It's much better to maybe go with some JavaScript solution. Okay, pros and cons of this solution. The first pros is it's PHP solution. So if you are here, all the PHP developers, it's much easier for us to start working with PHP instead of JavaScript or some other solution. It's really simple to integrate. You saw it's like, I don't know, 100 lines of code. It's also standard based, so you can use your WAMP server, you can use this on JavaScript, Android, iOS, or any other devices. The cons is this one, no HTTP fallback by default, so you need to think about that by yourself. It's low level abstraction. It's different style of programming because programming for WebSockets, it's not the same as programming in way of PHP. And if you want to scale your application, you need to do it by yourself. Okay. Just to go a few slides back, you see this is this is loosely coupled architecture. So this real-time web stack with Ratchet, we just changed with Fire. As I said, this demo doesn't work properly on my virtual machine, so I will skip it. But idea is to put here whatever you want. It can be SOC.js, it can be Socket.io, whatever you want. For this demo, the Fire is used, but you can use any other thing you want. The pros and cons, it's not simple messaging, it's actually PubSub. It has connection fallback, so you don't need to think about that. The Fire is there for you. Redis support is built in Fire, so you can just connect to the Redis, same as in Ratchet. It's pretty simple to integrate, but cons for us is it's not PHP, and you still need to scale by yourself. As I said, there are some other side-by-side, this is called side-by-side solution, so you can use Socket.io, Socket.js, Signal, Air, or any other real-time stack. I showed you the stack guide, so you can check it, what you can set up here. The easiest solution for have a real-time application is to use the hosted service. Especially with Pusher and Symfony too, because you have bundle for Pusher and you just need to write like three lines of code. Actually, you can put that in one line. With configuration, it's fine. So basically, you do something, you push that to some hosted solution, and then hosted solution broadcast that to you. The good thing is that you don't need to think about scaling. It's pretty simple, it's powerful, it's scalable at the moment. It's managed and dedicated and has direct integration with the Symfony with third-party bundles. The only cost is that it's third-party reliance, so it will cost some money. But it always depends how much money you will spend on developing your stack or how much money you will spend on buying some hosted solution. There are other hosted solutions like PubNub, Real-Time Call, Firebase, Simperium. You can also see the tech guide for more, and I will show you the demo for Pusher thing. So basically, what I need to do is just comment out the Redis part. Okay, so basically, as I said, this can be a one line of code, actually two lines. The only thing that we have for this third-party bundle is Pusher. We need to have Pusher app ID, app key, and app secret. Regarding the JavaScript part of code, it's simple as a file. So basically, Pusher chat is this, just Pusher, new Pusher, and give your secret key here. actually the app key, and everything is ready to go. In browser it looks like this. Okay, it works.
It's a little smaller than the entire solution hosted on my machine, but it's like a few milliseconds.
Okay, let's move forward.
This is the app that we are developing at Locastic. It's
called Peruvian. It's marketing tool. Actually, it's a real-time dashboard for Google AdWords Analytics. So you set up your goals and everything in real time is refreshed for you. The first step was built with Symfony 2 as a backend API provider and RabbitMQ, which workers written as a Symfony console commands, and frontend is built entirely into AngularJS. For MVP version we did it was pulling. It was just regular Ajax call every 5 minutes, I think. And now the second version, we have decided to move to host the solution, probably the pusher. Why pusher? Because it's maintainable, it's quite easy to integrate, and we don't need to think about practically anything. And we are like more oriented to Symfony than JavaScript technologies, so it's much easier for us to set up something in the cloud, host it somewhere and use that for our application. Regarding the references, as I said, this Phil Legator is really, really cool guy if you are talking about real-time applications. If you Google anything about real-time applications, real-time APIs, he will probably be first three results. Also, his real-time tag guide, React, Ratchet, Fire, Pusher, this bundle that we used for the pusher, and this example that I show you are actually on the GitHub on his account. It's quite simple to set up everything. You have documentation and you can test it by yourself with no problem. Thank you, and I think we have time for the questions, so 10 minutes I think.
Okay, just a few words about load balancing the several servers when we high load experience. Okay.
Well, as I said, we didn't move to our hosted solution, so we will probably resolve that with hosted solutions, so they will think about scaling. It's not our problem anymore if we use their services. But as I don't have experience in scaling this type of application, I cannot answer that question with 100% sure that I will give you the right answer. So if you are using your own stack, you are responsible for scaling. So that's not like, as I'm familiar, it's not right really easy task to do in this way. But if you are using the hosted solution, maybe you will save a lot of money, especially on that part.
Another question is that pusher is not free, so it's
you can create free account.
Yeah, no, it's a premium model. But for instance, for this application, do you find something else instead of pusher, and how much pusher costs for this application?
We are in a phase of moving that to the pusher, so I cannot answer on financing things. But by our calculation, we will probably save some money because we will spend a lot of time. If you are using Ratchet, it's not 100% ready for production, and who knows what will happen with that in the future. And as we don't have so much experience with the Node.js, I'm sure that we will save some money by using especially if that's part of scaling. Or we can of course, hire someone to do that for us, but I think it will save much more time for us to use the pusher.
What about the directories? So for me, personally, we have also project company, and we have some real problem with support notification with circuit here, to constant chart application on our own, and we all the time have problem with stable connection and other different things. And pusher is one of the first what we can find in Google, but do you research something similar to the pusher?
PubNub is similar to pusher. They are competitors in that field, like maybe two most famous at the moment. They are using slightly different methods, I think, but they are providing the same thing at the end of the day. So that's like maybe second solution. But you have on this, just a second. There is quite a list of. So you can check here, here, host real-time services, so these are the lists, so you can check, for example, everyone with short description, and then you can see the pricing, and definitely, I didn't talk about that, how to pick the right framework, but you should consider five or six things. Do you need to support for mobile applications? Do you need to which technology you want to use, and stuff like that, but you have really good talk from the field, I think 45 minutes, just about picking the right framework for your application, so that maybe can answer the your question. But there is quite a number of third party provider hosted solution for this kind of problem.
Do you personally try Node.js Socket.io, so without any PHP or like PHP React or Redshift?
I didn't.
You just drive the PHP and they decided to switch to the pusher. Yeah?
We started to investigate that, and our conclusion for this app was that we will save a lot of time and a lot of money if we go to the host. For now, for the hosted solution. Maybe when application grows big and then the expenses for pusher or some other application will be high, then we will maybe change the stack. But at the moment, this decision is like saving some money. Okay. That's the only reason why we decided to go with that.
If we're talking about real-time, it's always a question how many parallel connections possible, and what was your thoughts in PHP? I mean, per process. Simultaneous connection process.
Sorry, can you be a little louder?
Of simultaneous connections per process in PHP that you managed. I mean, you should keep large numbers of connections live.
But you are in a real-time application. Yeah,
yeah.
You are keeping them, but you are saving several resources. Not expanding them as in pooling method, because you are hitting a lot of more.
Yeah, but with PHP, you're talking about implementation in PHP, and how many connections could you keep alive with React PHP?
We didn't push the stress test on this, so I don't know, but my pre-assumed, what I think is that it's not related so much to the PHP, because you are using communication through the WebSockets, not through the PHP. The Redshift is only the framework that gives you PHP framework to use with the WebSocket.
So basically for a socket, you don't keep connection alive?
Sorry, can you please?
You should keep connection.
The question is about how you make connection alive. Because if you leave connection,
that's how WebSocket works. It's not how we do it.
For instance, if you use socket here, it's also WebSocket, and if you not all the time ping the server. HP server. It's how to make connection live. Connection is dying and you can your chat doesn't work. So you, for instance, by default, connection is alive.
Well, if connection is dropped, API will try to revive that connection. That's something that you have inside the.
It should done by the server.
Sorry?
It should done by the server. Response back is to make connection live.
But if you are in limit, server.
Just
limit.
Okay, thank you for your talk. Actually, I got the question of this guy. So, actually, the question was about how you keep a live connection through WebSocket. Because this WebSocket connection handled by Rochette, and Rochette works through MAMP protocol, and inside MAMP protocol there is ping messages via every 3 seconds or something like that. Am I right?
Yeah, sure.
Probably. I didn't investigate that much.
Okay.
This is a true problem. We already stuck with it. And this means that when you start chatting with some else, your connection is alive sometime and it's dying. For instance, if your browser is open and others user has a browser is open for some time, when you try to put something, is nothing to happen because connection to the server of your socket is closed, and you should keep this connection alive. If you don't send the subject request to stay connection alive, even if user nothing to put there. So this is the question is about that if you try to use your solution or Ratchet or just socket with Node.js. This is also a real case if you try to use mobile stuff.
Yeah, but I told you that in our cases we decided to not put that in. Actually, we will move because from all the things that we are getting as a feedback pusher should be a good solution for us because we don't want to think about it.
Yeah, it's a good step because you really get to get it from real problem. Any questions? Thank you very much.